Think it should be all right to start. All right, so welcome to my third lecture. We continue discussing the two most important algorithms in the area of p-groups, so p-quotient algorithm and now today p-group generation. P-group generation is to some extent based on the p-quotient algorithm in the sense that we will use this covering. So let me briefly recall what we have done yesterday. So we started by introducing and discussing this lower exponent P series. The terms of the series are Pi of G, and each section is elementary abelian. Every subgroup is characteristic in the group, and the first term is the Frattini sum. So this was a really important series we've used to use induction to prove this construction of a weighted polycyclic presentation. So this was then the p-quotient algorithm, which constructed this weighted polycyclic presentation, and also an epimorphism from the given group onto that group defined by that presentation. And an important tool in that construction was this covering group. So if we have a p-group which has degenerator p-group, and we realize it as a quotient f over r, where f is free of rank d, then we know that the p cover h star is isomorphic to f over r star, where r is given by this normal subgroup here. And this is a minor technical thing I should maybe emphasize. This realization of h as a quotient of a free group with degenerators has really just done in the proof where we've showed that the cover can be defined as that group and it satisfies all these properties. Remember later on, we had groups which weren't defined necessarily on a minimal generating set. Well, in fact, they aren't because we have a polycyclic sequence. So the number of generators was usually n when the group order is p to the n. So in general, the p cover wasn't realized as a quotient of a free group of rank d. But this is one way to construct the covering group. If you realize your group as a quotient of this free group of degenerators, then the covering group can be defined like that. We've seen an alternative construction, you know, where we basically added more generators. For each non-definition, we added an additional generator, and then there is a result saying that the resulting presentation is a presentation of the covering. Anyway, this is just a subtle thing. And we have lastly discussed application. So we had seen that this p-quotient algorithm had been used to construct some examples in the area of the Burnside problems. Now today we discuss p-group generation. So what is this about? The main idea is to get new groups out of old ones. We want to construct p-groups, p-group generation. And for this we need the notion of a descendant. So let's take a degenerator p-group of p-class C. Then we define a descendant of that group to be a degenerator P group H, which has G as a quotient, namely when we quotient out the C's term of the lower exponent P series. Okay? So G is degenerators, P class C, H is a descendant if it has the same number of generators, and if we quotient out PC of H, then it's isomorphic to G. This is what we call a descendant. And we call the group an immediate descendant if H has P class exactly one more than the P class of G. Yeah? So in general, if you have a descendant, you only require that this quotient H modulo PC of H is isomorphic to G. The P class of C can be more. Yeah? If it happens to be exactly one more than the original P class, then it's an immediate descendant. So maybe it's best to look at an example. Here is again elementary P, 2 group of order 4. Its 2 class is 1. Right? Here is D8, dihedral group of order 8. Its 2 class is 2. And now we want to see that D8 is a descendant of G. So G has P class 1. So we consider the quotient D8 modulo P1 of D8. So we have to quotient out PC of the group, where C is the P class of G, to see whether we have a descendant. And indeed, well, this quotient is elementary abelian of order 4. so the 8 is a descendant, first of all. But the P class of the 8 is by one larger than the P class of G, so it's an immediate descendant. All right? What about D16? Right. If we want to check whether it's a descendant, we take the Frattini quotient, yeah. D16 modulo P class of G of D16, which again is elementary abelian, so it's a descendant. But now here we have a case where the P class is not by one larger than the original group, but by two larger. So this P class here is original class plus two. So it's not an immediate descendant, but it's a descendant. All right. Now here's an important point. If you take any P group of P class greater than one, then this is an immediate descendant of some other P group. For example, of this guy. Yeah? It's easy to check just by the definition that K is an immediate descendant of this group. And this holds for every group of P class greater than one. Well, but P groups of P class one are kind of boring because they are just elementary abelian groups. So this tells us every P group, well, either is elementary abelian or it's an immediate descendant of a smaller group, smaller P group. So if you want to construct, well, all P groups to some extent, you can use this fact and building your groups by constructing iteratively immediate descendants. And this is what P group generation is about. Basically, it allows us to construct immediate descendants. So given some degenerator P group, some P class C, what do we want? Well, we want all immediate descendants, call one of these guys H, up to isomorphism. And as I just said, if we have such an immediate descendant, then, well, by definition, we know that this quotient H modulo PC of H is G. And the normal subgroup here, well, is elementary abelian and H central. This holds for every immediate descendant. We've seen something like that before. Ricoh theorem 13. If we have a degenerated P group, which has the given group G as a quotient, and the normal subgroup we quotient out is central and elementary abelian, what do we know about this H? Well, we know it's a quotient of the P cover of G. This is exactly what we have proved in the section on P covers. So we have our first theorem. Every immediate descendant is a quotient of the P cover. Which is good, because we already have some kind of understanding how this P cover looks like and how we can construct it. So this is where we can find all our immediate descendants. They are all quotients of the P covering. So this is what's happening. This is the rough outline of the p-group generation algorithm. What is the input? Well, again, we have a degenerator group G, and well, we also need some information about its automorphisms if you really want to do this task. So for this purpose here, let's assume we also have some description of its automorphism group, by which I usually mean a set of generators. And the output is, well, a list of all immediate descendants up to isomorphism, given by weighted polycyclic presentations. And if we want to iterate this, then we also need, well, their automorphism groups. So in this variation here, we also compute a description or generators of their automorphism groups. So once we have this algorithm, we can really start with an elementary abelian group, construct its immediate descendants, and just iterate, and then we get all immediate or all descendants of that group. And if you do this for all rank, then basically you can construct all P groups of any given order, in theory at least, right? So this is what we discuss today. So the setup in the following is that G is our group of P class C. We have the covering group. And as I said, if G is realized as a quotient of a degenerator group, then the covering group can be realized by that group. Problem, what quotients are immediate descendants? So not every quotient of the P cover gives you an immediate descendant. So we have to decide which quotients are actually good. And here's a couple of definitions we need in order to discuss this. The first term I want to introduce is the so-called P multiplicator. The P P multiplicator of G is, well, basically the kernel of the projection from the cover onto the goon. So this can be defined as general as that. You construct your covering group by some means, and then you have a projection onto your group G. The P multiplicator is just the kernel. If you construct your covering group using this construction, F over R and F over R star, then of course the multiplicator is isomorphic, or is R over R star. Yeah. So in the proofs, it will be quite convenient to stick to this construction here, where we have G be given as F over R, and G dash, sorry, G star is given as F over R star, and then we can simply say the multiplicator is R over R star. Yeah. But you can phrase this independent of the realization of your group, because it's simply the kernel of this map, which is well defined. So this is a P multiplicator. What's the nucleus? The nucleus of G is PC of G star. So now the group G has P class C. So when you take the term PC of F of R, well, you get the trivial subgroup, because G has P class C. So what does it mean? It means that PC of G star lies in the multiplicator. And this is called the nucleus. The nucleus lies in the multiplicator. And lastly, here's the definition I want to give. So if we have an immediate descendant, well, then we know already that it's a quotient of G star. And the kernel of this map, well, lies in the multiplicator. And we call now any subgroup of this multiplicator allowable if it gives us an immediate descendant. So take a subgroup of your multiplicator, a proper subgroup of your multiplicator. It's called allowable if the quotient is an immediate descendant. So it's basically just giving a different name. You call those subgroups you're looking for allowable. And of course, now the question is, what are the allowable subgroups? So far, we've just given a different name. It didn't really help us to solve the problem. This is the first step to solve this problem is this lemma here, which characterizes allowable subgroups. So basically, if you have a subgroup, proper subgroup of your multiplicator, then it gives you an immediate descendant if and only if it supplements the nucleus. Yeah? So remember, the nucleus lies in the multiplicator. The subgroup lies in the multiplicator by assumption. This subgroup is allowable if and only if these groups together give you the whole multiplicator. Yeah? So in other words, it's you have an allowable subgroup if and only if it supplements the nucleus in your multiplicator. The first characterization. So let's prove this, because it's really an important ingredient in the whole algorithm. So this is a setup. We have proper subgroup of the multiplicator. I have two directions to prove. So first, let's suppose we have such a subgroup which is allowable. Okay, so what does it mean to be allowable? Well, by definition, it means the quotient D star over that subgroup is an immediate descendant. So by the isomorphism theorem, if you take G star and quotient out Z, well, you get F over M. So this guy, F over M, is an immediate descendant, just by assumption. And eventually, we want to show that the nucleus supplements, the subgroup supplements the nucleus. Okay, so F over M is an immediate descendant, which means if you take that group and quotient out PC of that group, you get your original group. Okay? So you take the immediate descendant, F of M, and you quotient out PC of that group, which can be written in this form. It's isomorphic to G. It's just the definition of being an immediate descendant. On the other hand, well, we know that G is isomorphic to F over R. Now we can use the third isomorphism theorem to rewrite this as F over M over R over M. So now we have G written in two different ways as a quotient of F over M. F over M, and then you divide out this subgroup, or F over M, and you divide out R over M. It's both isomorphic to G. But now the thing is, this subgroup here, PCF M over M, PCF of M, is contained in R. So how do we see that? Well, first of all, M is contained in R by assumption, because we choose it as a subgroup of R. And PC of F is contained in R, well, because G has P class C. So what have we found so far? We have written G as a quotient of two, where we have two normal subgroups of M over M, but one normal subgroup is contained in the other. Yeah? So if they give you isomorphic quotients, then they must be the same. Simply, it's simply an order argument. We talk about finite quotients here. If this situation occurs, then they must be the same. Okay, so R is really PC of F times M. And now we quotient out R star, and we get that the multiplicator is really the nucleus times our allowable sum. Yeah. So the arguments itself aren't too difficult, but I agree. I mean, it looks a bit technical, but when you look at it long enough, then hopefully you agree that this is true. And so if your group is allowable, then it supplements the nucleus. Now, what about the converse? Suppose you have a subgroup of your multiplicator which supplements the nucleus. Well, this can be written in this form. And from this, we deduce that R is M times PC of F, exactly what we had in the converse direction here. And now, if you factor out M from this equation, you get that R over M is this term. So what do we want to show? We want to show that the quotient of G modulo Z is an immediate descendant. This is what we want to show. So let's take this quotient, which is F over M, and compute its subgroup PC of H. What is PC of H? Well, you can rewrite it as PC of F times M over M. And now by what we've just shown, this is R over M. So now what happens if you take the quotient of H modulo PC of H, PC of H? You get F over R. So H modulo PC of H is G, which tells us H is at least, well, it's a descendant. This is the definition of being a descendant. And to show that it's an immediate descendant, you just have to show that the P class of H is C plus 1. But this follows from construction because the P class of G star is C plus 1. So we are done. So this really classifies allowable subgroups. You only have to look for those subgroups of the multiplicator, which together with the nucleus give you the multiplicator. And yeah, I should stress that. Remember that this P multiplicator is elementary abelian. And we do work over prime. So this is essentially a vector space over GFP. So if you have constructed your nucleus, it's a subspace of your multiplicator. You only have to look for other subspaces, which basically supplement that subspace to give you the whole multiplicator. So it's a problem in linear algebra, so to speak. Okay, so here's one example, D16. What are the multiplicator and the nucleus? Well, the multiplicator is basically generated by the new generators. If you've added to the P cover. And in this case, it turns out the nucleus is generated by A5. So an allowable subgroup is a subgroup of your multiplicator which together with A5 gives you the group generated by A5, A6, A7. For example, here are three subgroups of the multiplicator, and it's easy to see when you throw in A5 to either of them, you get the whole multiplicator. So each of these subgroups here are allowable subgroups, and they give you immediate descendants of order 32. So if you quotient this out, you quotient these groups out of your covering group, you get a group of order 32. And it's an immediate descendant by the previous result. Now, there are other subgroups which are allowable. For example, this guy here, A5, A6, A5, A7. It's also an allowable subgroup. It gives you an immediate descendant. But it gives you something which is isomorphic to something we've already got by quotienting out one of these groups. So this indicates that when you take all allowable subgroups and form quotients, well, you get all immediate descendants, but it's not up to isomorphism. You get many more. Yeah? So you have a complete list of immediate descendants, but usually you want things up to isomorphism. If you do that, you have isomorphic immediate descendants. So this is the next thing we have to discuss. When are two immediate descendants isomorphic? And for this, we introduce yet another notation. We call two allowable subgroups equivalent if the corresponding immediate descendants are isomorphic. So remember, if you have an allowable subgroup, U over R star, which lives in the multiplicator, then the quotient, G star over that subgroup, is isomorphic to F over U by the isomorphism theory. Okay? So if these two groups are isomorphic, then we call the allowable subgroups equivalent. Well, again, this doesn't really help us solving this problem. We just introduced a new notation. Why is it useful? Well, this is really an equivalence relation. And you can rephrase this equivalence relation differently in terms of the automorphism group of G. Right? This is why this notation had been invented. So we want to basically decide when are two allowable subgroups equivalent. When do they give immediate descendants which are isomorphic? So we have to talk about automorphisms a little bit. Remember, the input of our algorithm also requires that we have generators for the automorphism group. Let's take one of these generators, or in general, let's take one of these automorphisms. And suppose our group is generated by elements A1 up to AD. What do we do? Well, we extend this automorphism to an automorphism of the cover. So how do we do that? Well, we choose pre-images of AI, of these AIs, in the free group, such that the corresponding coset is AI. And similarly, we choose pre-images YI for the image under AI. So we simply choose pre-images of the generators and of the images under the automorphism in the free group. And then we define a map from A star from the cover to itself by simply mapping XI R star to YI R star. One could actually make this definition a little bit easier by simply saying, okay, we lift the generating set of G to generators of G star, and similarly, we lift images. For the proof, however, it will be more convenient to really have a lift up to the free group level. This is mainly just for the proof that we take this detour via the free group. In general, it really just is some kind of lift of your generating set and images. Well, of course, we have to prove a little bit here. We want to know that A star really is an automorphism of our cover. It's called the extended automorphism. And of course, it's not unique, right? There are some choices involved. We can choose elements for our lift. But the good news is if we restrict it to the multiplicator, then it is unique. Okay, so let's prove this. So the first step is to prove that it's a well-defined homomorphism. So let's take an element in the free group, G, which is just a word in the generators X1 up to XD. If this element happens to lie in the normal subgroup R, well, then what do we know about the image? Well, this coset GR, well, it's just the identity in F over R. And alpha maps the identity to the identity. So alpha of GR is the identity in the quotient FR. Now, by definition, we know that alpha maps this element, or this word in the X's, into a word in Y's. Yeah? So we have equality here. So this tells us if this word in X is in R, then the corresponding image where we replace the X's by Y's also lies in R. Now, if this element happens to lie in R star, then it follows from that observation that the corresponding image also lies in R star. Now simply remember that R star is made up by commutators and pth powers. Yeah? And this essentially proves that we have a well-defined homomorphism. Yeah? So if you have some element here in R star, then the corresponding image also lies in R star. So it's well-defined. Now, why is this homomorphism surjective? Well, this again follows from Bernstein's basis theorem. We know that alpha is surjective, right? So the images of, these YIs, modulo the Frattini subgroup, generate the Frattini factor and therefore the whole group. But the new images we have chosen have the same image in the Frattini quotient. So they also generate the Frattini quotient. So by this Burnside spaces theorem, we know that their lifts also generate the whole group. So it's surjective. So this is our new automorphism, extended automorphism. So we have to argue now that two extensions have the same restriction to the multiplicator. Now remember, if you have two different extensions, they only differ by elements in the multiplicator. And if you consider words in R, well, then they are products of p-th power some commutators, because eventually this R here is contained in the Frattini subgroup of the whole of F. So elements in R are words, are products of p-th power some commutators. And the multiplicator, again, is elementary abelian and central. So all this together really implies that when you restrict to elements in the multiplicator, then your map really is uniquely defined by alpha. All the additional things you can attach to the lift to get a different extension, they don't have any impact when you restrict it to the multiplicator. So the punchline is, for every automorphism, we have an extended automorphism of the cover, and its restriction to the multiplicator is unique. All right. So this lemma now solves the isomorphism problem for allowable subgroups. So we have two allowable subgroups, meaning they give us immediate descendants. Then the statement is, the immediate descendants are isomorphic if and only if the immediate subgroups here, sorry, the allowable subgroups, are mapped onto each other by some extended automorphism. So Alexander talked about orbits yesterday. So what we have here basically is an action of the automorphism group on subgroups of the multiplicator. So this says two allowable subgroups are isomorphic if and only if the allowable subgroups corresponding to them lie in the same automorphism group of G orbit. So it goes back to computing orbits if you want to solve the isomorphism problem. Again, proof is quite straightforward. Suppose we have an isomorphism between these immediate descendants, between F over U and F over V, then the terms of the lower p-center series are mapped onto each other. This is one of the properties of these the series. So let's have a look at the terms of the series. So the first group is an immediate descendant. So we know that the group modulo its C term of the lower exponent series is isomorphic to G. And this C's term here is exactly R over U. Now the same thing happens for the other immediate descendant. So here PC of the group is R over V. Now an isomorphism from F over U to F over V maps the corresponding PC terms onto each other. So the isomorphism phi maps R over U to R over V. And, so we have an induced automorphism of G. If you quotient these normal subgroups out, we get a map from F over R to F over R, which is an automorphism of G. So any isomorphism between two allowable subgroups, sorry, between two immediate descendants, gives us an automorphism of the original group. Call it alpha. And as we've just seen, there is an extension. We can lift this back to an automorphism of the cover. And now this alpha star will map our allowable subgroups onto each other. So this is what we have to show, then we are done with one direction. So for this, take an element in U. It's a word in these xi's. Now, G of U, again, is, it's the identity in the first group. So the isomorphism maps it to the identity in the second group, which is 1 times V. And now, again, just look at what happens. So this isomorphism basically can be applied to the individual xi's here. And showed. So eventually, you get that this is the same word, but in the yi's, where, again, the yi's correspond to the images under from the xi's. So if you have such a word in U, then the corresponding image word lies in V, which essentially proves that alpha star maps this quotient U over R star to V over R star. So So we have found an automorphism, an extended automorphism, which maps these allowable subgroups onto each other. Now the converse is really simple. It follows from a general argument. If you have any group and a normal subgroup and an automorphism of the group, then the quotient H over N is isomorphic to H over the image of the automorphism of N. So if you have an automorphism of the cover which maps this normal subgroup of the cover to that normal subgroup of the cover, then of course you get an isomorphism of the corresponding quotients, which are exactly the immediate subgroups defined by these allowable subgroups. All right. So I hope this wasn't too technical, but anyway, it fits on one slide, so I thought it's really a good idea to present the proof. So maybe later when you revise this, then you understand all details. But you see, it's a nice short proof, and now the isomorphism problem really reduces to a construction of orbits under your automorphism. Okay, yeah, I should point this out just to introduce the notation. So if you have any automorphism in G, we have this extended automorphism. And by this lemma, we have seen that the image of an allowable subgroup under this induced extended automorphism is also an extended automorphism. So you get a permutation of all allowable subgroups. Just a permutation, so let's call this pi of alpha, pi for permutation. Okay, so we have to say a little bit about the automorphisms of an intermediate descendant. As I said earlier, if you want to iterate your P group generation algorithm, in each step you would need the generators for your automorphism group. So just very briefly, let me say a few words about how we get these automorphisms. In tomorrow's lecture, we talk about this in a bit more detail. So H is now an immediate descendant. We want to know basically its automorphisms. And remember, automorphisms, well, are just isomorphisms from the group to itself. Yeah? So basically here we have two immediate descendants of G, which happen to be the same. And we know that they are isomorphic if and only if the corresponding allowable subgroups are mapped onto each other by some extended automorphism. And this might be taken as a motivation why we consider this set here. We know that the automorphism group of G permutes the allowable subgroups. Yeah? So in particular, we can ask for the stabilizer of a particular allowable subgroup. So let's take the allowable subgroup which defines our descendant, which is M over R, R star. Consider the stabilizer of this allowable subgroup under the action of the automorphism group. So take all automorphisms of G so that the corresponding permutation stabilizes this guy. You get a subgroup of the automorphism group, sigma. What do we do next? Well, each automorphism is an automorphism of G, so we can extend it, theta star. And then since it stabilizes M over R star, we can restrict it to the quotient F over M. So what do? We have an automorphism of G which stabilizes some allowable subgroup. We lift it to the cover and then restrict it to the quotient. And what we get is an automorphism of that particular immediate descendant. So we have already found one subgroup of our automorphism group of this immediate descendant. But at this stage, it's not clear that this subgroup is not non-trivial, but it isn't in general. What else do we need? Well, we need a generating set for all automorphisms of H, which, when restricted to an automorphism of G, are the identity. This group can, in fact, be quite readily be constructed using some one co-cycles, and we discuss this in more detail later. So this is actually not difficult to construct. And then the theorem is, well, take S, your group induced by the stabilizer, take this group T here and add the inner automorphisms, then you have the automorphism group of your immediate descendant. Yeah. And the only critical part really is getting S, and I'll talk about that in more detail tomorrow. Okay, so this is the algorithm. We have as input our group, G, like its automorphism group given by some generators. And in this particular case, we also have a number integer S, because we only want to construct immediate descendants of order by the power p to the s times larger than the original order. If you want all immediate descendants, you just run over all possible s. So what do we do? Well, First step, construct the P covering group. Well, this was me. Oh, surprise, was so interesting. So the first thing is to construct this covering group, right? And then for each generator of your automorphism group, compute its extension, which kind of is easy. Compute the induced permutation of allowable subgroups of index P to the S, because only those guys give you descendants of that order. Compute the orbits under this, under the action of these permutations of all allowable subgroups. And then for each orbit representative, call it Z, form the corresponding quotient and get a presentation for it. And lastly, compute the automorphism. So what I've just done on the last slide. This is the main outline. So it looks really, really simple, doesn't it? But I will say a little bit about this later. The implementation is actually really sophisticated. So I think, I mean, Eamon O'Brien did most of this work, and I think it's about 22,000 lines of C code, because this, of course, has to be polished a lot to make it efficient. I mean, there are many tasks in this list which by default are not really doable if you just do it brute force, in particular the orbit stabilizer construction. So there are some serious efficiency concerns, and one has to polish it a lot. But anyway, the outline, the general structure, is as easy as that. Okay, one example, because I think examples are really good to see what happens. Let's take all immediate descendants from starting with the elementary abelian group of order 4. We just do the same thing as what I just said. We construct the covering group. We've seen this now a couple of times. This case turns out the multiplicator and nucleus coincide. They are the same. So what does it mean? Well, it means every proper subgroup of the multiplicator is allowable, because every proper subgroup trivially supplements the nucleus. We always get the multiplicator. So what about the automorphisms? So the automorphism group of G, when it's just GL22, can be generated by two automorphisms here, the usual ones. We need to discuss its extensions. So firstly, we have to lift it to an automorphism of G star. And we can simply do it by taking the first two elements and map them to the same words as before. A lift. However, we have to decide what happens with A3, A4, and A5. And we can determine that because these guys are represented in terms of the generators in our presentation. For example, alpha 1 star of A3, what is it? Well, what is A3? A3 is a commutator of A1 and A2. It's just the image of this commutator. Now, it's a homomorphism, so it's simply the commutator of the images. So the image of A1 is A1, A2. Image of A2 is A2. And now we can use these commutator rules for products to see that essentially this is just the commutator of A1 and A2, which is A3. Yeah? So the image of A3 is A3. And now you simply do this for all the other guys as well. So A4 is given by A1 square. Yeah? So it's the image of A1 square, which is A1, A2 to the power 2. You collect this and you get this element. And lastly, the image of A5 is A5. So this is how you can recover the images of the other generators of your covering group. And for the second automorphism, you do exactly the same thing. I mean, here it's even easier because you don't introduce any products in your images. You just permute your generators. So these are the extended generators. Those parts stayed the same. I'm now interested in the immediate descendants of our group of order 8. So to get a group of order 8, we need an allowable subgroup of index 2. That is of rank 2. And these are the 7 subgroups which have rank 2. We have to consider the orbit so we act with the extended automorphism group here on the set of these allowable subgroups. If you do it, then you get 3 orbits of allowable subgroups. So orbit of length 3, orbit of length 1, orbit of length 3. And now we take one group from each orbit, take the quotient, and get our immediate descendant. So these are the orbits. Choose one representative from each group. For example, for the first group orbit, take the group A4, A5. We quotient this group out of our covering. And this is particularly nice because quotienting out A4, A5, what does it mean? Well, it means you basically set A4 and A5 to be one. You simply ignore A4 and A5. So look at this equation presentation. Set A4 and A5 to be one. Well, what you get is this nice little presentation here of D8. For the second presentation, this tells us basically A3 equals A4, A3 equals A5. So do this in your presentation of the cover. You get the quaternion group of order 8. And lastly, set A3 and A4 to be 1, and you get a presentation of C2 times C4. And these are the three immediate descendants of order 8 of C2 times C2 up to isomorphism. What about immediate descendants of order 16? Well, the same covering group. This time we need allowable subgroups of order 1. Yeah. You construct orbits as before. So we have three orbits again. And if you quotient out an orbit representative out of your covering group, then you get again three immediate descendants, this time of order 16. And well, more precisely, you get C4 times C4. Split extension, C2 times C2 times split C2 times C4, and C4 split C4. Yeah, here's one example of C4 times C4. So this is how it works. Now, what about immediate descendants of order 32? Well, this is easy. There is only one immediate descendant of order 32, namely the covering. The covering group has order 32, so it's the only immediate descendant of that order. So this is how it works in practice. And just a couple of words on practical issues. Running a bit late, so maybe we should speed up a bit. So as I said already, there are practical issues attached to this algorithm. And the main problem is the number of allowable subspaces, so the size of the orbits eventually, when you have to compute the orbits and the stabilizer. For example, if you start with an elementary abelian group of rank D, then every immediate descendant has class 2. And the multiplicator here always coincides with the nucleus, and its rank is, well, d squared plus d over 2. So if d is large, you have a large elementary abelian subgroup, and the number of subspaces which you're interested in also grows quite rapidly. So you have to compute really orbits on a huge set, which is a problem. So the approach here is really to try to avoid this, and you can do this by exploiting certain characteristic structure. Talk about this in more detail tomorrow. In this particular example, if the group you start with an elementary abelian group, then the covering group has class 2, which means the multiplicator, a P1 of G, which is the multiplicator, has a characteristic decomposition because it's a Frattini subgroup. So you have two characteristic subgroups in your multiplicator. And of course, if you act with an automorphism, it preserves this decomposition. So when you look for orbits of subspaces, you can use this characteristic decomposition. I'm not going into detail here, because it's actually quite complicated. There's a lot written about that, so I refer to the paper of Amen if you want more details about that. And lastly, in the last 6.5 minutes, I want to talk briefly about an application of that. As I said, p-group generation can be used to construct p-groups, basically all p-groups up to isomorphism when you start with an elementary abelian subgroup and go up. So what is known about classifying p-groups this way? Well, first of all, how many p-groups are there of order p to the n, right? This is maybe an easier question. The problem is even that is not known in general. So there's no hope that you get a complete classification. So let's briefly recall what's known about the number of groups of a given order, or the gnu of n, African deer here. The gnu of n is the number of isomorphism types of groups of order n. It has been studied in detail. I just want to mention a few results. So a very old estimate has been done by Piper in 1993, estimated that the number of groups of order n up to isomorphism is given by this expression here. And basically, he counts certain choices for pseudo subgroups, fitting subgroups, quotients, and extensions. So it's kind of a complicated argument. We are interested in groups of prime power order. So what's known for that? Well, Hickman showed that the number of groups of order p to the n is at least approximately asymptotically, I mean, p to n cubed, approximately. And the idea is here to just count groups of p plus 2 to get a lower bound. Sims, Newman, and Seeley have proved an upper bound. Basically showed that the number of these groups is also p to the n cubed, asymptotically. And the remarkable thing here really is that there is a trivial bound. Every p group of order p to the n, well, can be represented by a weighted polycyclic presentation on n generators. How many relations do you have? N power relations and n times n minus 1 over 2 commutator relations. Each relation is given by a normalized word, so you can simply count how many possible presentations you can have. This is an upper bound. It's also p to the n cubed. So it's kind of remarkable that the proven upper bound and this trivial upper bound kind of and lower bound actually are pretty close. Okay, so there are many p groups of order p to the n. So we've already seen some numbers of two groups at the very first lecture. So Bettina Eich, Hans-Ulrich Bescher, and Eamon O'Brien used two-group generation to construct or enumerate some of these groups. And indeed, the number really explodes, as you just would expect from the formulas we've just seen. And this also just indicates that when you want to classify p groups by order, that it might be difficult because there are so many of them. And it was Charles Leadham Green. Coming back to this conjecture I mentioned earlier, saying that all groups are two groups, if you just count how many groups of order at most 2,000 are, it's this many, how many groups of order 2 to the 10, which is 1,024, well, this many, it's almost the same number, and how many of these groups have two class 2, well, this many. So almost all groups of order at most 2,000 are two groups of order of p class 2. This leads to this conjecture that almost all groups are two groups of two class two. Nevertheless, you could try to classify some groups of small prime power order. For small prime powers, this has been done by a number of people. P equals 5 gets a bit more interesting because there the number of groups really depends on the prime. So the number here is basically a polynomial expression in P. And some coefficients depend on residual classes, certain residual classes of depending on the prime. Yeah? So if you choose a certain residual class of your prime, then you basically get a polynomial expression in P. Yeah, for P to the 6, there's an even more complicated term. There had been many classification attempts in the literature, and eventually Mike Newman, Eamon O'Brien, and Michael Vaughan-Lee completed the classification. For groups of order p to the 7, similar results, but the formula is getting even more complicated. But it's the same structure, right? So if you look at it as a polynomial expression in P, and some of the coefficients depend on residual classes of your prime. Just one quick word about the approach. Well, if P is less than n, you can use P group generation. For P greater than n, well, basically they used Lie ring techniques. So they used an analog of the P group generation algorithm to classify Lie rings, and they used the correspondence between certain Lie rings and P groups. I'm not going into detail here, but it's really a lot of technical work involved in this classification. And it's not really sure whether this approach has any future, because you see it's already getting quite complicated, and computations are just getting too difficult. Anyway, if you look at these formulas, you know, they are all polynomial expressions in P, and some coefficients depend on residual classes. And this leads to this famous Bohr conjecture, which I definitely have to mention in the last 50 seconds. Yeah, so this conjecture basically says that this behavior happens for all prime powers. So the number of groups of order P to the n can be described by a formula as we've seen before, a polynomial in P where some coefficients depend on the residual class. So in other words, if you partition your primes into these residual classes, then you have a finite set of polynomials. And for each residual class, this polynomial describes the order of the number of groups you have. So a few things are known. Number of groups of of order p to the n in p plus 2 is PORC, so satisfies this. The number of groups of order p to the n whose Frattini subgroup is central is PORC. And of course, all the previous examples we've seen support this conjecture. And recently, Michael Borglee has shown that groups of order p to the 8 and exponent p is PORC as well. There had been a minor glitch recently because there was, I think it was also Michael Borglee and Markus Dussoltoy, they have investigated a class of p groups, and they were able to show that the immediate descendants of these p groups, these numbers were not PORC. And since the number of all groups is made up by immediate descendants, they were a bit afraid that this might be an indication that the PORC conjecture isn't true. But of course, there is still hope, because it could, of course, be that the number of descendants of two different groups are both not PORC. But of course, you add up everything in the end. So it could still be that in the end, everything is PORC. Anyway, so this conjecture is still wide open. I mean, there is some evidence that it might be true. But in general, it's wide open as far as I see. Okay, so this is what we discussed today, and I think then I should also stop. We talked about descendants, immediate descendants. We discussed this p-group generation algorithm. In particular, we introduced p-cover, nucleus, multiplicator, allowable subgroups, and extended automorphisms. Briefly talked about automorphism groups, and lastly, about the group number function, GNU, and these four conjectures. Okay, yeah, that's all. Thank you.